Hey, this is Moo, and welcome to DOSBox. Welcome. You know, even back in 1992, Microprose understood that tits make everything better. Okay, we're going to be playing Darklands, which is a DOS game that I loved from 1992, as I said, and then patched for maybe another year or so. There are a lot of patches. It was a very ambitious game and had a lot of bugs. I understand that's kind of the norm today, but back then, before the interwebs, when it was a lot more difficult to get patches, shipping with bugs was a big problem, and it was a problem that Darklands had. It was one of the reasons it didn't sell as well as I think it should have. It's a party-based RPG that, for once, thank God, is not based on some kind of half-baked, third-hand version of Tolkien via Gary Gygax. A lot of the ideas and mechanics are still pretty innovative, and it's one of the reasons that every couple years I still fire this thing up and spend way too much time on it. So anyway, here are your choices. Quick Start gives you a party of four people who are way better equipped than any of your characters will ever be, and with more skills and saints and knowledge. It's kind of a head start. I guess I could recommend this for people who are new to playing Darklands, but I don't enjoy it. This is what we're going to be doing. This is create a new party from scratch. This is also the button you use if you want to cheat and just import a whole bunch of really old alchemists and steal all their potions so that you can sell them. And this is the continue game button. So, let's just jump into it here. Alright, these are the four over-equipped jerks who we will not be using, nor will we be putting them into the party so we can steal their armor and then sell it. We're just gonna start creating new characters. The interface is a little bit clunky, and I probably will forget things from time to time because it's been a while since I played it. But, yeah, let's jump into it and see what happens. I'm going to create a new character. So we have four people, and I think what I'm going to go with is sort of the generic party configuration, where character one is a big brick face fighter guy who does a lot of talking. He's probably going to be pretty stupid. But he'll have half-decent charisma, and all of these characters will have as much strength as I could drop into them. And the reason for that is that in Darklands, your strength is almost everything. It determines how many hit points you have before you die. It determines your encumbrance, so it's how much armor that you could wear, and armor is really important. It determines how much stuff you can carry around. You can cheese around with your inventory a little bit, but you really do want a high strength so you can wear half-decent armor. Your strength can also get nerfed from time to time from various special effects and abilities and potions, so you want to have enough of a buffer so that you're not just standing still doing nothing. Endurance governs not actually that much. It does govern your blue bar, which is the endurance bar, obviously, and when you take a hit in combat, you lose endurance and you lose hit points. You typically lose more endurance, but the advantage of having high strength is that if your endurance goes to zero, you go unconscious. If your strength goes to zero, you're dead. So do not make the mistake of having a really high endurance and kind of a mediocre strength, because what that means is you'll just stay on your feet until you are dead, and then tough titties. Agility is really not as important as a lot of people think it might be. It does govern your chances to do things like climb walls, it helps you sneak around a little bit, but I found it of sort of lesser importance to everything else. And it's not really that big a deal as far as your missile weapon skills go, because those are going to raise pretty fast on their own. Perception is, it's moderately important. You will need it to do things like spot people's motives, although you can pray to a saint to help you with that. It'll help you avoid ambushes, and so forth. So, it's of moderate. Intelligence is pretty much, if you are the alchemist, you need a ton of intelligence. If you're anyone else, it's helpful. It'll help you, I think it helps you interact with people at universities and so forth, although other skills also come into play. But basically, this is the alchemist attribute. Charisma does help you interact with people, and you have to talk to a lot of people in Darklands. So, and it, depending on who you're talking to, you'll have different people in the party talk to them. So, this guy, the first character, the face, is obviously going to have a fair amount of charisma, because he's going to be the party leader most of the time. He'll be talking to guys they meet on the road. He'll be talking probably to a lot of guys at the city gates. But if you are the alchemist, you're going to be the one who's talking to the town alchemist to try and get formulae and training, because those guys are really crabby, so you're going to need some of this too. If you are the priest type, who's my character number 4, you are going to be doing a lot of talking at universities and monasteries, because you're going to have high religion, speak Latin and reading and writing, blah blah blah, so you're also going to need it. Let's just start making this idiot. So over here, you can cycle through a bunch of randomly generated names, which some of which are kind of funny. Good German stock, yeah. But let's come up with our own name here. Alright, he's going to be the guy at the front of the party, and he's a really heroic sounding name. Manfred Horsefeathers. That's pretty good. It doesn't automatically transfer the nickname. You have to create that. Horsefeathers is not going to fit, so let's just call him Horse. We can make him a woman. We can do a couple other things, but this is kind of his birth map, and here's his basic characteristics. If you make him a woman, you lose some strength, you gain some endurance and stuff. You gain a point of charisma. That's, Dark Ages Germany. You don't have any skills, obviously. This is where your alchemical formula are going to be. This is where all the saints that you know. But let's just get him born. Let's go, horse. So here you select your kind of family you come from. I guess you're still being born. Each one of these has a different effects on your stats, which you can see in here, the number of free experience you have to improve those stats, and it gives you a little bit of a bump to the various skills you can see over here. Horse only cares about how strong he is, as he should. So let's see, if he's noble, town tradesman, he loses strength. That's no good. That gives him perception intelligence. He's a kind of craftsman. I guess he's okay, fairly well balanced. He gains strength and loses some charisma as an urban commoner, as a rural commoner. That's interesting. All right, so it looks like commoners is the way to go for him. If he takes rural, he loses a little bit more intelligence, gains a point of endurance, and he's an idiot anyway. So here he is. Born in the sticks. So now you have 97... Oh, you also got a pretty good pool of experience to spend here. So now we can change the attributes. And attributes can go up... You can buy them up for a certain amount at 1 experience per point, and then they go to 2 experience, and then to 3. Although I think you can only go as high as 40 in this stage. So let's see how hard we can take a strength. It's 1 point per point of strength, and Okay, so 29 starts costing twice as much, but I want these guys to have as close to the cap as I can, and I might just put them at the cap. Let's see, so that last, it's, for points 30 to 39, it costs them 2 points per point, and then 40 costs them 3. Let's see if we can get away with that. Alright, so now we have to push his charisma, because as stupid as his background is, he is going to be the spokesman most of the time. He can get 29 charisma, which I guess is serviceable. What else does he need? He could use some endurance so he doesn't fall down quite as often. I guess it's at a flat level. So he can go up to 29 endurance without losing a lot of points. Agility is of sort of inconsequential value, as I mentioned before, so these will enable him to see stuff, so he can see who's shooting at him. Whatever. Alright, so now he's capped on strength, and he's got reasonable values for endurance, perception, charisma, kind of a half decent value for agility, and he's dumb as a box of rocks. Perfect. Now we're done cheating attributes, we spend all experience. Let's go. At the age of 15, his first job is one of these, and these jobs, there's an unbelievably complicated kind of jobs and backgrounds progression table that you can look at if you play this game and you go look at the hint book. And the hint book, this is one of the first games where having the hint book is almost mandatory for playing this game. It has one of the best manuals I have ever seen for a game, the basic manual. It's actually fun to read, but the game is way too complicated to understand. You miss a lot of stuff with just the manual. So in the hint book, there are certain career tracks. You can take this all the way up to abbot if you start as a monk. There's a certain trail that takes you to hermit, and I can't remember what it is, which is too bad, because hermit's a really good profession. Apprentice craftsman, you can go up to the merchant track. Thief gives you a couple. Obviously, if you start as a recruit, you can go up to the soldier track. And here's one thing about this game which is a little bit weird. Whatever your last profession is, whenever you start to go adventuring, your highest weapon skill will determine what you start with, what kind of weapon you start with. But unless your last job was as a soldier, you don't get any armor. And, I mean, you'll get armor soon enough, but it really helps in the beginning. It would be nice if they kind of mentioned that, or if you started a recruit and went to some other job, you got to keep your armor. Anyway, let's see. What is the most important thing for him to consider? Well, it's the job that gives him the highest strength. He gets 41 as a recruit. 41 as a laborer, and 51 experience. That's actually pretty good. He's got a lot of... That will give him a lot of experience to deal with. Gain 1 as a peasant with 48 experience. And he'd lose... I don't know why being a hunter causes you to lose strength. That's pretty strange. There are some professions that cause you to lose strength, like alchemist and some of the clerky type professions. So you want to start with a high strength even if you're going to be the party alchemist. Let's just let Manfred be a career soldier. The other thing is that I'm only going to take these guys through 2 careers. Once you start getting to 3 careers and up, you're gaining a lot of experience and possibly a lot of good equipment, but your physical stats start to go down. And you do age in this game. and I do not want these guys to suffer too much here because they wanted to spend like an extra 5 years as a clerk or something. So let's just start him off as a recruit. That's going to give him only 38 experience to go, but it's going to increase his strength and his endurance and what have you. Now let's do it. All right. So this is during his first tour. If you've ever played Traveler, this is kind of like that. He's only got 38 experience to spend on things. This column here, the first number is the number of points you get automatically in a skill just by being that. So just by being a soldier, he's getting a lot of skills and weapon points and weapon skills. The second number is how many more points you can buy with your experience. In your first career, you get a big block of experience, which is why maybe recruit wasn't such a good idea. So as you can see, he's getting a big block on all these weapon skills and a fair chunk that he can drop into them afterwards. He's not getting very much in this intellectual field. Some of them he can't increase at all, like alchemy, because he's a recruit. And then down here, he's got sort of moderate values for these sort of crafty skills. These weapon skills, I don't care about too much. I mean, they're going to suck at combat, and they're going to be healing a lot at the beginning, which is kind of par for the course when you start with an inexperienced party without cheating for money. But these skills are going to go up just by fighting fairly quickly. So I'm going to ignore them as long as I can. Now, religion is really important, and I'm just going to give him the 2 points he can buy there. Religion determines what saints you can call, and more importantly, how much virtue you can gain by giving money to the church. And our next stat here, which is virtue, determines how fast you regain your virtue points, which you use to call saints. And I think it also affects your chances of calling those saints in the first place, and also it has some effects in character interactions. This is very hard to raise. So when we get a surplus of money, we're not terrible at fighting anymore. We will be studying a lot of religion, and then once we get it up, like, say, past 60 or something, which is quite a haul, we're going to start giving money away to the church so we can increase our virtue. Speak common, he's going to need that. This is just basically talking German, which helps you in most interactions. Speak Latin only really helps you at the university. They're very snooty at the university, so our religious guy is probably going to be talking for us there. Read and write, I'm still not really convinced as what read and write does, although if you spend a lot of time in the gas house, you can be a clerk with a high enough read and write skill, which gives you pretty good income per day. But that's a kind of a tertiary benefit. Healing, you really only need one guy in the party with a very good healing skill, because all the party's healing per day is based off of that guy's healing skill. I might buy it anyway. Artifice allows you to do things like pick locks and craft things. It gives you some more opportunity. It's the sort of catch-all crafting skill, and I like that they just dropped it into one skill called Artifice, because in too many games, you have a whole bunch of crafting skills, and you might be all excited to say, oh boy, I can build a bunch of stuff, and you dump all your points into crafting, and you realize that you don't really care about crafting that much because your whole job is beating people up. So it's nice that they only have one skill. Stealth is just what it sounds like. Streetwise, my second character will probably be the Streetwise character, but, you know, whatever. Drop some points into here. That's another interaction skill. Also drop into stealth, because stealth is a skill that the whole party needs, because when you have a stealth situation, you will check to see if someone steps on a twig or acts like an idiot based on the lowest person's stealth. Riding, not going to affect him too much, but it will eventually. And again, that's like a weakest link kind of skill. Woodwise, this helps you chase animals away and, I guess, roast marshmallows. It's moderately useful. It's also good for ambushes, so go ahead and build that up. Yeah, I'll buy all these other skills. The last thing I'm really concerned about is these weapon skills, because, like I said, they're going to go up anyway. I suppose we might as well push up bow a little bit. And this is one of the situations like a Mountain Blade where you just have a bunch of points, you don't care where you put them into, you just start raising your worst skills. Eventually they are going to go for impact weapons, because I like Warhammers. In the beginning, they're going to be using mostly captured weapons off of bandits, which is going to mean clubs and falchions. So, you can't really go wrong with either of these. Flails in this game a little iffy on. Eventually, just to kind of mix things up, all these guys are going to wind up, like, studying a couple of different weapons. But bow is going to take a while to get to, and they definitely will be using them as soon as they get them. So, I'm just going to drop points at the bow. Sort of preemptively spending. I'm pre-ordering bow. And let's see, what else does he have here? In the unlikely event he finds a flail, I'll buy that so it's on par with his other terrible weapon skills. I mean, 11 is just awful. But that's all of experience points. Let's go to his next occupation. So once he picks this, he's going to be 25. Now he can be a soldier. It's not going to increase his strength. Being a laborer would increase his... I should have taken laborer first. That would have made more sense. Peasant, bandit. Why didn't I take laborer or peasant first? I'm an idiot. That's okay. If we give him soldier, he might start with some better equipment. But like I said, I mean, you'll get equipment eventually. You know what? Fuck it. The army is not for him. So between these two, laborer, peasant. No difference in this. Those. He gets a little more skill points as a laborer. I'll just make him a laborer. He got kicked out of the army because he was too big of a jerk. Why not Pauling Rocks? Now he's 25. What have you done with your life? Pick up. And you, as you can see, like he's getting more skill. It seems like he's getting about the same skill points. That's just because his first bucket of skill points was so awful. More speak common. I speak Latin, sure. Some of this. It's too bad he can't increase his virtue. And he can buy another point of alchemy for absolutely no reason. Push up his stealth. His interactions with streetwise. Terrible writing skill. And put his last points of World Wars. Now he's 25, he is done. And if I was smarter and flip those two professions around backwards, he would be starting with better equipment, but that's my fault. He can blame me when he gets killed. So, I don't want to make him any older. Let's begin adventuring. Here he is in our available characters list. We're going to add him to the party. Here's his icon. So you can select, first of all, select his heraldry. They've got a bunch of goofy little things here, and they don't really come into play except that you can see who it is easier in the combat screens. Although, we're going to see that anyway because we're going to use all the body types. That eagle looks fairly pompous. Here, we'll go give him the shield. We'll give him the heraldry with a sword, which makes perfect sense because he'll be carrying a warhammer. Over here, you can select between generic fighter guy, chick with low-cut dress, skinny dude with a hood, and fatso. He's going to be generic fighter guy, so now we'll pick his three colors. Yeah, that's fine. Give him a very drab, kind of black and white sort of ensemble. There he is. Now let's open him up. Look at the character sheet. Here's all of his stats. Doesn't have any equipment. This paper doll, there's no, like, model on it. It's just your equipment. You know, limited resources back in 92 and whatnot. Here's all of his skills. This would be this formula. If he was an alchemist, he would see all the stuff that he could build in here. This, if he had studied religion, he would have his saints. And eventually when he does get religion, he'll be able to learn some saints at monasteries, but that's quite a ways in the future. Now, this is something that really confuses a lot of people. He starts naked, but really, he has this club. I'm sorry, horse. If I had been smarter, you would have been a soldier second. Normally he would have, some kerboily and maybe some leather armlets to keep him alive a little longer, but honestly, I don't like him that much. That's fine. Now I'm going to create three more characters. The first one will be... the second character is going to be another fighter type who is going to probably be our artificer, take a lot of streetwise, and do sneaky stuff if we really need someone to, although you don't need to a lot in this game. That's sort of like the dump skill character. The third character will be the alchemist, who will not be doing any alchemy for a while, because all they'll be doing is beating up thugs for money. And the fourth character will be our priest and Latin speaker. But I'm going to create those guys, maybe we'll fast forward it, so you don't have to suffer through it. And I'll do that now. Alright, and there's our party. We have Manfred Horsefeathers, the guy who's dumb enough to not get armor, big dumb face, reasonable charisma. Mostly he's just gonna hit things. We have the aptly named Boobs Von Boingboing, and they don't have a female model here, who is smarter and got to keep her armor, and also is gonna hit things, has more higher street skills, which will be of moderate import. Schmott Brainheim, who is our alchemist, and he's not going to be doing any alchemy for a while. He has one formula, which is Al-Razi's flea dust. You can see here's the mystical number, and there's a complicated formula that involves your alchemy skill, your intelligence, and the quality of your party's philosopher stone to determine whether or not you can actually build anything. And these are the ingredients that it takes. This becomes a little bit spreadsheety later in the game, but you can make a lot of money with it. Schmott guy has some equipment, I think. Oh, he starts with some flea dust, which we'll probably just sell for money, because that's not really that good. And then Friar Fuch, who I was surprised I could actually make him a friar in his second career. I forget what the requirements are for a friar, but they're roof. He knows one saint, Saint Catherine, the patron of philosophers, preachers, students, librarians, and maidens. Oh, this is a good one. Catherine is one of the 14 holy helpers and is known for her faith and conversion. She provides a small increase in intelligence, a good increase of charisma, and a tremendous increase to speak common. Unfortunately, I don't think that he can actually call St. Catherine because he has a 0% success. And spending divine favor doesn't matter. So his virtue or his religion is too low to call this saint. And as you go around to different monasteries and such, you can learn about different saints. You spread them around the party so that different people can burn up their divine favor pools to gain inconsequential advantages. But that's how it works. And he has a club. Well, we have a very badly equipped party, only one of whom was smart enough to get armor. And I think that's going to do it. This fifth slot here, once in a while you take a quest, you'll get, like, someone from the Haunts or, like, a village elder to accompany you and absorb damage for you. But you can only have four people in the party. So we have four people with no money and really crappy equipment. Can I save yet? Nope. Let's begin the adventure. Gather around a comfortable fire at the Gasthaus in the city of Kempen.
Then we are agreed? Asks Horse, because he's stupid. We will swear this pact of loyalty to achieve justice and glory for all.
Everyone nods. I didn't agree to that. I just want them to make money. Anyway, this is apparently the narrative. This is the railroad section. You all swear a pact as blood brothers to see good and avoid evil and to bring everlasting honor and glory to your names. You don't actually have to do this. This game is very sandboxy. You can pretty much do whatever you want. But that's what they say. You look around at each other.
Now that we have a goal,
Horace remarks wryly,
how should we achieve it?
Let's visit the market and the guilds in search of better equipment and more training,
suggests Boobs.
I've also heard that the churches and monasteries may take on students. Once we find some teachers, we could just stay here and work at various things until the money runs low.
That's a really boring idea, Boobs. I mean, they will be doing that at some point, but we start our life as adventurers, so let's just, like, get odd jobs and hang out at the tavern. But everyone nods because she's a girl.
A wise plan, remarks Schmott, but why not take action now? Thieves infest the back streets here at night. We can gain repute, experience, and a bit of plunder by eliminating these scum. Let us also listen to rumors and visit the Altmarkt to learn about tasks the merchants may have for us.
Schmott has the right idea. I mean, they're going to get sick of it by the time they've killed their, like, 40th group of bandits, but that's what you got to do, I guess. You can go to the market and talk to various, like, league representatives and merchants will sometimes have quests for you, and mostly they're kind of dumb, like, travel 600 miles and go get my helmet off the top of a cliff and bring it back within 4 days and I'll give you, like, you know, 12 pfennigs or something. But once in a while you'll get really good quests. The ones that are the best are the Raubritter quests. And Raubritters, which we can't take right now, are basically, you know, evil German knights who live in strongholds. You go kill them, and then you go back and get a pretty hefty reward. And the nice thing is that because everyone hates them, you can get rewarded for killing the same Raubritter from, like, six different people. There is an unhappy look on Fuch's face.
Don't we need fine...
He's eating.
Don't we need fine armor and good weapons? Maybe the sale of one or two valuable items will give us the funds to help everyone here. I am loath to venture to the dangerous countryside without good equipment and lots of rations.
I mean, you don't have anything. I mean, eventually you'll sell the Fleetus potion, but none of that's going to really help. I mean, eventually, I think early on, we're just going to kill local bandits, gain tiny amounts of local reputation, get wounded a lot, Sell the stuff. Eventually, you know, pick up some slightly better armor. Buy missile weapons. And then maybe we can actually go and do something. But the first time you leave town, it is really dangerous. After discussing these issues, you decide to just spend some time here in the gas house, the local inn. That's a great idea. Immediately leave the city of Kemen for the open country. That's an even better idea. Go out to the main street or slide out the back into a side street. When you have to heal or craft potions or study, well, especially when you have to study, you have to stay at the guest house, and you know you'll pay a daily rate that depends on which city is in and what your reputation is like. Otherwise, you can try kind of camping out in the park, which is where we're going to be spending a lot of time because we'll be beating up on thugs there. But I mean, I don't know why you would want to. Well, let's find out. So here we are in the guest house because we're lazy. Here you can enjoy the good food and pleasant conversation of the guest house common room. However, staying over a month will lead to problems. Meanwhile, you decide to catch up on these things that usually don't pan out. I mean, the problem with the local news and rumors, once in a while you pick up something, but I think that was a feature that they were really looking to implement to either interface or plug the expansion for this game, which never came about because of all the problems with this game, and also because Microprose, while making some of the best games in PC game history, really had the business sense of course. Relax with a good meal and get 8 hours sleep for 1 groschen and 8 pfennigs. Very rarely actually choose this. And that's because the next option is take up residence to study, work, pray, experiment, etc. When you do this, you still pay the 1 groschen and 8 pfennigs, but everyone in the party who doesn't actually need to rest and heal can do other things. They can pray for divine favor. They can get odd jobs that, depending on their skills, will, you know, earn a little extra coin. They can study, which is really what you want to do while you're here, assuming you have enough money. So really there's almost no reason to do this unless you're specifically wanting to kill 8 hours. Visit the stables where you might buy or sell horses or mules, which we can't afford yet and can't really ride anyway. Store some items with the innkeeper. One of the bugs in this game, I remember, has to do with storing items at the inn. So I generally don't leave anything at the inns. I will use this option, and that just kind of gives you a common inventory pool in case your inventory gets really messed up and you have to reorganize it. So you just, like, throw stuff into the vault, take it back out. But anything that's extra, I'll generally just sell. Reconsider the composition of your party, exit the main street, exit to a side street. We're going to be doing one of these things when we finally get out of the damn inn. But for now, I'm going to save this game. And I think I have an old... No, I don't. You're also limited to a certain number of saves in this game, so periodically I'm going to be going back and cleaning out the save game file. I think it's like after 99, things start getting very strange. But anyway, there's the exciting beginning to Darklands, the 1992 game, which is better than almost all games being made today. But thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.